The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
All right. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the ProTrader webinar series here at Bookmap. Today, we have Kevin Toch. It's part two of the webinar. He presented on Thursday and did a fantastic job. And I have to apologize, guys. Like, you had many questions in there. We didn't get to any of them. That's what part two is about, is, well, part of it. Kevin's going to finish up with his presentation and go through some examples. And he has even more examples, from what I understand, to go through. So it's a real treat for us. So I won't introduce him or anything. I'll let him do that. Risk disclaimer, though: trading futures, equities, and digital currencies involves substantial risk of loss and is not suitable for all investors. Past performance is not necessarily indicative of future results. Kevin's contact information is all here. Guys, I will be putting this into the chat periodically, as well as the link to the recording from part one, if you want access to that. So don't worry, I'll put it in the chat. In fact, here it is. I just put it into the chat in GoToWebinar for you, so you have all of his information as well. And without further ado, let's turn it over to Kevin.
Hi, Bruce. Hi, guys. Welcome to part two. So, second round of this thing. I have a little surprise for you guys. I've made a quick video today at the open on the e-mini. So you really have something fresh. I have received a lot of messages from you guys, and thanks for that, following the session we had Thursday. And a lot of you guys have told me that it was kind of hard for you to see the screen due to the fact that it was a vertical screen. And it's a good thing, because the volatility is decreased a bit. I'm not sure if you guys have followed the VIX. But it's not as volatile. Liquidity starts to come back little by little. We're still far away from what we used to have, but still it's not as volatile. So I was able to use an horizontal screen, and I'm going to share a lot of examples. And I think what we could do, maybe, if Bruce is okay with it, we can go over the examples and then do a small Q&A session about the examples, and then after that move to the next example, and in the end, we will wrap it up with all the Q&As from last session and maybe new Q&A questions that came up during this session. Okay, so let's start with the screen sharing. It's always the same game, finding the right monitor with my multi-monitor setup. Bruce, do you see my screen?
I see my screen connected to GoToWebinar screen.
Okay, wonderful. Okay, let me click on the video I did today, which is 6th of April 2020. Do you guys see my screen? And let me also pop the Q&As, the questions. Not sure if you guys are able to answer as well. Yeah, and good morning to everybody. Here I'm in Europe, so it's not the morning. We already in the late afternoon. But good morning to all of you guys. Can you confirm if you see the screen in full?
Yes.
Yes. Wonderful. Okay. Wonderful. And I have now. I'm a little bit more organized than last time. I can see the answers flowing like a tape during fast market conditions. Okay, so, I have even a more recent example, which is a very small trade, just in a very quiet market, just to share with you. Let me find it back. Okay, this is a very small scalp here. So this is in a very slow market. And this is a setup that I wanted to share with you guys, because it happens all the time. And if you watch, I've done a presentation for Bookmap Thursday, but I also did one in 2016, and I was already talking about this setup in 2016. I believe it was April 2016, and it's a W into a cluster liquidity zone. Okay, and look, it's the setup here. My entry is not perfect. You see the cluster liquidity zone, it's very visual in Bookmap. You can see I put it the order fields we're pushing a little. The timing was not really perfect. We're pushing a little through. Here I'm thinking, what should I do? Should I keep? I already put an exit, which is very conservative. It's kind of a scratch. I will take two or three ticks because it's when the market is very slow. Not sure at what time, but I believe it was before the e-mini open. Okay, but I thought it gave you a good idea of how it looks. So you have a test of the liquidity zone, and then a little rejection of it. Me, I chased it a bit. I was thinking of entering a second contract, but we never went. You see, the second contract is at 562.5. I'm ready to remove my order because I believe that it might push through. So that was today, and this happened today. But in the end, it's slow. So I believe here I'm thinking, should I keep this? It looks like it's not going anywhere. But I felt like the even when the market was going down, because if you look, the market kept going down for the last minutes. But I felt that in the way it went down, there was still good buying pressure. And then there is a very little push, and I will be filled immediately, if I remember, at the level. Yeah, you see, and someone is manipulating it. You can see it in Bookmap. You see here the yellow thing. It pushes it into my limit order. So a question that you guys might ask yourself is that why did I? And here I'm trying to work it again. And you see what I did. Is that I'm trying to work the level again. Yeah, it's done. I'm trying to work the level again because sometimes I work the same levels like 10, 15 times in a period of 15, 20 minutes. Okay. So that's an example when the market is very quiet. Can you confirm that you guys can see the screen in full now with the new way? I captured it in a horizontal way to make it easier.
Yes, we see it. Your logo, Rubik's Cube, and text.
Yeah, sorry. I'm not very familiar with this thing. Someone did it. The graphic designer set it up, my Camtasia, for me, and I don't know how to remove it. So it's the reason why it's there.
Okay.
And I'm sorry about that. Yes, I'm sorry about that. But the important thing here is are the color zones. And now with the heat map, you have with the liquidity on Bookmap, it makes it easier to see. So regarding the trade I had before, the question you guys might ask yourself is, why did I put my order at a place and I was able to exit exactly at the place where I put it my order? Well, it's because mainly when I watch the book, I'm always evaluating the current volatility. And when I say the current volatility, it's visually. So I know how big the oscillations are. And as soon as I see a move that seemed to me like it's bigger than the current volatility, I have an opportunity to enter trade. Okay. So here, this is very, very interesting. Why? Because this was done about 1 hour 25 ago, and it lasts for 10 minutes. And the market conditions where pretty, it's the open, so it's a bit more volatile than what you've seen before. But for an open, it's pretty quiet, and the market makers are pretty much in control. Liquidity providers, of course, it's not the ES we used to have, but still, it's better than what we had like 1 week and 2 weeks ago due to the COVID-19 crisis. You remember I discussed Thursday the fact that liquidity disappeared from most of the books. So here, of course, it's the S&P, and you can see it's only 16, 28, 48 at the bid, which makes it very easy for the guy at 65, that has a large order. And now I know a lot of guys are skeptical because the way we trade as professional liquidity providers, I see myself as a professional liquidity provider. I'm putting limit orders the more I can in the order book, and I give the ability to people to enter and exit the book. And so the thing is that we see this as one single person, and I know it's one single person. Why? Because the way the order moves, come back, removes, this is not a market, typical market maker order. Also because the market makers, they tend to put an equivalent amount of orders all over in the book. They will not, unless they're trying to control the range at a specific place, but here there was no reason to do so. I have a good reasons to think that the order at 2,565 is one single player. Another thing you can do, if you watch, you have in the data you receive from the CME, you have the ability to see how many traders, how many single orders, I mean, are at each price level. And you will see that even when there is when there is one level with more orders, it's not like there are 80 different traders with 15 quantity, for example. You can see that you have about the same number of traders at each price level, but one price level has way more orders than the other price levels. So that's another indication that shows you that you have single players that are able to manipulate this market. In a normal situation, someone with a capital that allows him to clip 100, 150 contracts should not be able to move the ES. I mean, in this time, those sharks are there in the market and they play that all day on the E-mini S&P, which is usually a market that they cannot trade because there is no way to manipulate it when the liquidity is usual. You can manipulate it, but not. It should not be done. It's forbidden. Don't misunderstand me. But you cannot do it with such a small quantity. Okay. So let's take a look here. What you need to know is that since the market has been selling off for a long time, I had a more and the pressure was to the downside. I had a pretty in the beginning. You will see I'm making a mistake because I'm very committed to the short side. Okay, and you will see I will lose trades, have more losing trades, and then I will reevaluate completely the situation. You see here, I put it an order to sell, and I was expecting, since you see that we had a very strong sell into the limit cluster zone, and I believe the market would go, look, here I put an order to exit at the entry, because I think I start to doubt, or another order to add to the position so that my average position will be a little higher, okay? And you see the market, when you, and particularly at the open, most of the volume are done during the first hour and the last hour of trading. And due to that, it tends to go and check out if the volume is real. You see, I was pretty much stuck in this trade. I exited close to the entry. Now I try, and I have still the manipulation order at 566. So here I try to reevaluate, and I feel like I'm not able to read it. So I'm waiting a little. I'm watching my book map, see that it starts to turn into a kind of market maker type market. Why? Because you have a lot of cluster zones above and below. I'm a little worried by the contract. You see, I'm showing it with my mouse, the 200 contract. And I think I didn't check, verify, but I think only a part of it traded. Because if you look to the bookmark balls, the one that shows the delta, you see that the size is not, the size of the ball is not that big. I think if the 200 contracts were executed, the ball would have been bigger. Now I'm still committed to the short side. You see, I'm trying, and now you can see that my initial trade was not a too bad idea. But again, I'm completely wrong. You see, and I'm trying to find a way to exit. I'm scared to be squeezed. I'm thinking of taking a full stop, which will take probably 5, 6, 7 times this time to make up the loss I will do for this. But after I see that the market rejected the level of 69, and so I put another order to add, and I'm thinking of exiting in the zone of 66.75 or something like that. And look, now I'm in a situation where I have the level here. I'm checking my book map, and I have the level, I believe it's the level of 71. And it has been there for a long time, and it has been rejected already once. And now I believe, because there is an order of 100, you see it goes fast. Now we already crossed my entry, and I believe the market will go and check the order of 100. So I exited one of the contracts. I'm started to gain confidence that this market is going to the short side. But I'm not sure if you see, it's not flushing down. When I'm watching my order book there, I would like to see kind of a flush effect. but it's like there is a power which are bidding algorithms that are pushing the level of 64.25. You see, it's pushing. It's like very mechanical, bam, 2-3 ticks at once. And so I start to lose more confidence to the short side. And I'm trying to exit, and it makes it very hard to exit. You see, because we use limit orders. You use a stop only when you're getting killed. But with the techniques we use, you will have a very high amount of winning trades, and the losing trades we wipe out like probably 5, 6, 7 winning trades, okay? If you're able to manage. So here, I aggressively entered to the short side. I believe the market will come again and try to see if the liquidity at 67.25 is real. But I start to feel stuck again. And then I think in a couple of seconds, I will start changing my mind and seeing that I'm fighting against some bots that are on the long side. Because it's like to go to the downside, it goes a little bit, then it stops, and then it reverses. And to go to the upside, it goes straight for 10 ticks. Like I'm fighting with the trend here. Okay, and when I say the trend, don't get me wrong, we don't really work with the concept of trend, but I mean the micro trend. Okay, I'm not talking about the trend of a 60-minute chart. I'm talking about the current trend for the last 2-3 minutes in the book. Look, I put an order at the entry. I exited with a 1-tick loss. I'm expecting to short the level of 71.5. Why is that? Because it was rejected. You see, I was not able to be filled. In my job, when I'm not able to be filled, it means that I'm at the right side of the market. Okay. If it's hard for you to get filled, then it means that you're doing a good job. If you filled in 2 seconds, it means that there is another smart trader on the other side of the trade that is happy to give you the fill. Maybe me, who knows, or maybe not. But we will always try to trade levels that are difficult to trade. And a lot of people that are doing the same as I do, or bots that are doing the same as I do, they compete to try to get an entry at these levels. Look, I'm trying to exit with a scratch trade, so no loss. And I'm not able to. So now I gain confidence and I tell myself, the long side is probably the side I should be, but I'm still stuck with one lot here on the S&P. I have someone that is pushing here. You see, he was pushing the price to the upper side. And why did I keep this trade longer? Because I was surprised that even though he put at 575 contracts to the bid, there was no real reaction to the upside. And you can see it very clearly in Bookmap. You see the order appeared in Bookmap, and the market did not really follow to the upside. If they were more aggressive sellers at this specific time, the market should have rushed for 20 ticks. Okay, so now I'm starting. I have like a small long bias, but I'm starting to doubt it a little bit. And here I'm ready to exit with a 2-tick loss on this thing. You see, on the level of 71.25. And again, it's very hard to get filled. Okay, so I'm thinking of adding, trying to make it a better average price. And here, the only thing I start thinking about is exiting and reversing, okay? Because I feel like the market will go. If I don't act fast, I will have a loss that will take me 2-3 hours to make up, okay? Look, here, okay, now I'm exiting with a loss, but I gained confidence to the long side. So I start to get aggressively working levels that I seen that are defended by bots, to the long side, and putting an exit immediately, because what I'm doing is actually I'm remembering the price that was rejected before, and now it starts to work for me again. Okay, now I still have one contract. I'm looking to see if we can have a push, and I put an exit, and you see I changed my mind very fast. Okay, it's always like you know, when you do this type of trading, it's always like you're rethinking the situation every 45 seconds to a minute, okay? And you know you do have an edge, because the strategies you use allow you to have an edge. Bookmap on the right helps you to have a clear understanding of the general context and the type of market we are in, because as you know, guys, I've told you that last week, the context is very key here, okay? So here I'm pretty committed still to the long side. You see, I saw something that made me remove my limit order to exit, but I was not able to. I was filled earlier, okay? Which means that there is a good conviction to the long side. Of course, it's a small volatility market, only quick scalp, 4 tick here, 3 tick there, 2 tick loss. Sometimes the losses that are not often, they way bigger than the gains. So you always need to try to manage the losses. Another question that you guys might ask yourself is like, yeah, but what are you doing? You averaging down. No, I'm not averaging down. There is a big, big difference between scaling in and averaging down. Scaling in is having a predefined number of contracts you're going to trade. Those number of contracts you're going to trade, you choose to enter them little by little, depending on your conviction. If you have a very high conviction, you can go 2 contracts at the time. But if your level of conviction is low, you will just scale in here and there, 1 contract, 2 contracts, maybe 3. Okay, so that's scaling in. It's predefined. You know already in what type of environment you are and how you're going to trade. Averaging down is when you start with 1 contract, it's going against you, and it was absolutely not planned. You usually trade 1 contract and you decide to put another one, then another one, just because you're losing. So that's not a strategy. That is something dangerous that will destroy your account. So it's very important to understand the difference between a predefined scaling in strategy and an averaging down mistake, huh? Because averaging down is not a strategy. Remember one thing that is very important. You see the pressure, the long pressure here, something that I almost don't do because the market starts to gain speed. I exited with a market order. And you see the pressure continues to go. And I think that's it for the video. Yeah, very good example of a low volatility market. So what I was saying, when you enter, you lose objectivity. If you don't have a predefined plan regarding what you're going to do, you're not able to take an educated and wise decision when you're in the trade, okay? It means that when I say an educated decision when you're in the trade, I mean regarding the size, regarding the scaling in strategy. Like if you enter in the market and you usually trade 1 contract, it's hard. Guys, I'm not going to lie to you. If you trade 1 contract, this is why it might be better for someone with a small account to trade micro contract instead of trading 1 e-mini big, not the big, but the e-mini S&P, the traditional one. Okay, because me, I don't trade micro a lot. But to learn, it can be very good because trading 1 contract puts you in a position where you either right or wrong. I think I already said that during the last session. Okay, that's it. What are the questions?
Okay, a few questions already. And guys, like I said, I apologize from last time. You had so many good questions and we just ran out of time. Hopefully maybe you copied and paste, copied and can paste your questions back in here. Let's see here. Someone's asking here about if you can talk about different strategies maybe, or do you have an English room or trading room? Or subscription or, you know, something like that?
You need to understand that I cannot talk while I'm doing that. It's something when you do that, you need to be focused. It's very hard. And it's also something that will be what's interesting would be to learn how to do it. But if you want, like, for example, if I'm sharing my screen and I have someone trying to replicate the trades I'm doing, you will always be probably with the lag, the time for my image to go to the computer, it will lag and it makes it very hard to copy. So here what I did to replicate the trades. Okay, so it's possible to do it when you know the strategies that you're working. Then of course you know where to enter because it's pretty simple. The strategies are pretty simple. The difficult part is to be able to recognize the context. Why? Because if you use a market making strategy in a trending context, it's very, very difficult to recover from the losses you can have from that. Okay, why? Because when you use a market making type of strategy, you will be scaling in and scaling out either part of a range. But when you use a trending strategy, you will put some orders, limit orders below the market on some levels that the book and bookmap gave you. And those two type of strategies, but hopefully, thanks God, in the indexes, we don't have much trends. Like, for example, a practical example, I've been trading gold. I was not supposed to trade, but there were too much opportunities on gold. So I've been trading gold a little bit before the webinar. I was talking with Bruce about it before the webinar started. If you use a strategy like that on gold, you would be killed. It's not appropriate. It's a strategy for a retracement market making type of market. Okay, gold. Right now, you have a lot of people that are going going market because they buy and they will get the underlying delivery of the market. And if you follow even the COMEX posted something about a new contract with the delivery, because due to the current context and the way central banks are doing quantitative easing and printing a lot of money, the gold and Bitcoin are two instruments that bring a lot of interest. Okay, so probably a lot of central banks, I know that in Dubai, for example, in the UAE, central banks, they buy gold, they buy a lot of gold, and they buy market, you know. So it's just to put things in perspective here. Don't get too overwhelmed. Those strategies are working well, but you need really to take the context into a state, and that's the most difficult part. Okay, and that takes time. It takes screen time. Okay, the good thing is that you can work on a simulator. If your simulator is replicating the exact market conditions, like a FIFO, first in, first out, and the queue, then you can practice for as long as you need to, and see if those things are working for you. But of course, the strategies, they have a very high probability of working, but when you have a losing trade, it's way more. It's not like a typical reversal risk reward strategy like you use with technical analysis. I'm looking at the questions here.
Yeah, so I can read them out for you.
Okay, sure.
Maybe that's more helpful. Sure. Let's see. Thank you for the presentation. How does the COB information help you make a decision? Tom, it looks like he's been using, you know, he's using the TT dome over there, more than the bookmap dome. He's looking at bookmap there more for the heat map and to verify the visual and also much bigger picture here, even though he's scalping on very low timeframes.
Yeah. Why? This is a very, very interesting, Bruce, what you just said, because I need to know where I am. Okay. When you like this, you don't really take, you work the flow, you trade, you know, it's probably the modern version of the pit trading. You know, me, I'm too young to, I would have loved to be a pit trader, you know, so, but I was too young to trade in the pits, but I believe that it's probably similar to what the pit traders were doing. So at some point when you're in the action, it's very important to have a general map that sets the key level that everybody is watching, because if you are buying based on order flow trades into a major multi-time frame resistance, there are not a lot of those levels, but you need to be aware of them and you need to be aware of their existence. And this is why generally before trading, I write down on a paper the key levels I'm interested in. Also, something that I can do with Bookmap is when there is a major natural, okay, because me, I make a big difference between what I call a natural support and resistance and what I call a predictive support and resistance. A natural one is the one that is showing on Bookmap right now. A predictive one is the one that you have compiled while doing your research, knowing that this is a low volume node, this is a high volume node, and so on and so forth. Bookmap helps me also to know the levels where there are big order for a long time. Because in the book you cannot keep track of everything. Sometimes you work the same price at a lot of different times, but usually you're not really aware unless it's a very key price on a longer time frame, it changes very fast. And the frequency is quite high. So you're not always aware of those longer time levels, which is why it's important to keep a general map to have a little idea of where you're standing in the range, in the current range, and what are the condition, the market conditions for the longer time frame traders. And when I say longer time frame, of course, you've seen the type of rates of trading that are practiced. So when I say longer time frame, it might be 1 minute. You see, 1 minute, 2 minute candles is kind of lower time frame to me, you know. So another question?
Yeah, sure. So a good question here from Max about how do you gauge which state of the market is in, maker or taker?
Oh, this is very good. That's a very good question. Well, you need to understand when you read the exchange rules for market makers, they need to keep an orderly market. Okay, they need to keep an orderly market. The problem is that while keeping an orderly market, they will gain a large exposure in the opposite direction of the move. Okay, so what you need to keep in mind is that they will always try to protect themselves. Why? Because they would like to increase the market impact as much as they can. The more the market impact is high, the less likely the liquidity taker is going to continue his large quantity order in one side of the market. Okay? So as soon as you see that the market is controlled, there is not much volatility, in your book map, you see a lot of price levels. Like we had in the first example, you have two zones with a lot of yellow above and below, and you have the market stuck into those two zones, kind of a balance. That's a typical market maker type market. Okay? As soon as you see a lot of trend, the liquidity disappear, a lot of speed, and the market pushing very fast in one direction and going to the other direction because the market maker needs to unload his exposure as much as he can, well, you know it's a market where the liquidity takers are in control. But most of the time, the market maker stays in control. And when I say the market maker, don't get me wrong, guys. I'm saying the market maker to make sure, to make it easy to explain, but it doesn't mean that there is one guy in a room with a hat, with a market maker right on the hat, and that is working and providing the liquidity alone for one market. But it's like a pool of liquidity providers that have agreements with the exchange and that act like, they act like one single player. They're not competing among themselves. Most of the time, what I observe is that. But there are also some markets where there is only one market maker. And to that, you guys go back and check the bankruptcy of MFG, MF Global. I believe it was back in 2011. And check out how many futures contracts have been ceased trading till the exchange found a new market maker. And it was the case in Australia on a lot of... I think on some of the ags in Australia, the market was completely closed. Okay, so this is why I love thin contracts, because you know that you're fighting against 80%, 90% of the orders you will see in the book are market makers orders. Okay, and this is even something that is more observable if you watch it during the Globex session. Okay, so not sure if this answers the question, which was a very good question.
Yeah, I think so. I think you could also answer with the context, reply as well. But a few questions here on Bitcoin, cryptocurrencies. Mm-hmm. You know, in these thin markets, the same kind of market making. Strategies or things that you just talked about with gold and thin markets?
It's funny, I had a debate about that with a trader. I'm not sure where he's located. I'm not sure if it's Hong Kong or Amsterdam, but we had a debate about that on Twitter. Just to make sure, I'm kind of a specialist. There are some things that I know very well and some things that I don't know anything about. Bitcoin, I've bought a little bit of Bitcoin in the past on the Bitcoin instrument to do some swings, But there is a CME contract on Bitcoin, but when I watch the book, there is no real scalping opportunities. I feel like it's a market maker market, but with not much volume yet. And I watched it this morning to make sure, and I've never traded it using futures, never traded it, and I don't have much things to say about it because it's not really my something I know about. But I've been talking with a guy, if you check out my Twitter, that is doing it, and he's doing it on another futures exchange. I'm not sure which one. Me, I mainly trade CME and Eurex, and I use some contracts of ICE US as indicators, but I don't trade them. Yeah, I used to trade the Russell when it was back trading at ICE. Not sure when that was, but now it moved to CME. So it's mainly CME and Eurex. So I cannot say much about it. Sorry.
Okay. Sounds good. So let's see. Are you using any other platforms for like higher time frame, or are you just using basically the DOM?
I use a lot of platforms. I'm okay. Trying. You know, I'm trying. I use a lot of platforms, but they have. Okay, and I'm not here to talk about, I'm not affiliated to anyone, so I'm not here to talk about. The only reason why I use TT is because the DOM, if you do that type of trading, am I used to it? I was used to Xtrader, you know, it's hard. Traders are creatures of habit. And I've been talking with Bruce. He tells me, yeah, use the DOM of Bookmap. I should try. I should try to use it. But it's not that there is anything wrong with something else than TT, but I've been using it for so long that I'm good with it. Regarding the other platforms, I use the Delta. I'm not going to disclose any brand because I'm not here to do any kind of publicity. But I use the Delta. The Delta is a pretty easy concept, so you can have it on a lot of different platforms. And I also use traditional charts, but I have them on TT. But there is another platform that I'm using just for the swing. Not that I should be using it, but I'm used to it, and I love to things that I've been doing like for 15 years. I'm just used to it. You know, I don't need to think for 10 minutes before opening something because I don't know exactly where it is in the settings. So that's it. But regarding Bookmap, it's like when it first started to, I'm not sure, Bruce, when you guys started the company?
We started, you were early adopter. I mean, I think around 2015 or 14, something like
okay,
that.
Okay, yeah. So I really was one of the first time adopter of it. I had one of my former students that was trading in a prop desk in Dubai, and he told me about it, and he started to use it. And then this is how I got hooked up with it. And also, I think at the time I was giving a course in London, I think one of the guys at Bookmap, I'm not sure exactly who, or he's still with the team, had used my course in some way. And so, yeah, so it was an immediate connection because it allows me to know what happened in the book 1 hour ago and watch if a level is being defended for a very long time. And yeah, it's priceless. It's priceless information because the other book is great, but it's gone. It's the instant. It's the information of the instant. And yeah, I immediately started to use it. Hope it answers the
definitely. Questions about using the DOM and also trading from Bookmap. You answered it already. I just wanted to mention something though, that for those of you out there wanting to trade from Bookmap and the DOM, there is a lot of functionality. I mean, you can basically configure the DOM and Bookmap any way that you want. So, I mean, and then some, you can make quite a DOM out of it that lots of different data columns are available. Just wanted to mention that. Let's see here. Does this mean that market makers, orders and limits are not real and then can quickly be pulled?
Actually, this is a subject that I discussed extensively during the first training that we've done together with Bookmap in 2016. But basically, market makers, they only use limit orders. Okay, so a limit order, it's real till it's not real anymore. You can remove them, put them back in, and you can pretty much do anything you want with it. But again, depending to the situation, if it's a market maker market, you know what to expect. If it's a very directional market, no one will start trying to spoof around. When there is real genuine volume, real genuine market taking and liquidity taking, no one will start to play those games when the volatility is very, very high. This is usually something that is played when the market is kind of controlled and that people are confident to manipulate it, for those that have the ability to manipulate it. Okay.
Okay. Let's see. I have a question actually for you while sure. I'm reading through these here about the trade management, because I know that, I mean, you've already explained it, and I know that you know the way that you are adding into scaling in and scaling out a type mm-hmm. of thing, and just doing that consistently throughout the entire time. But like you had mentioned on Thursday, so you know things go very, very well, but then there is that potential, and it usually happens mm-hmm. Once in a while that there's this one sure. massive move against you, mm-hmm. and then can be a pretty big loss. How do you handle or try to manage that? In this example you just went through, you were showing like, okay, I'm waiting to get back to break even, and I'm starting to scale and et cetera. Mm-hmm. What if you don't have that opportunity?
Well, you normally, if you're able to, it's a very good question. It's the whole, probably the most important, thing here. But you have different possibilities. The first one would be if you think that the move normally, okay, first of all, nothing moves market but fundamentals and news, and those are legit moves. Okay, so this is something you have in mind, that every time that when there is something change, as soon as something changes the perception of value from the value, the market is moving, and it will go and try to find the new price that is accorded and in line with the perception of the operators and of the market. Okay, so normally you don't have much real trend when you work indexes. Those trends, they come for good reasons. Okay, so most of the time what you have is the market going in one direction, retracing. You pretty much always have an opportunity, but you will have always during a year like those 6-7 days where you get killed. Like me, my worst the worst time was trading crude. I had a very big loss that took me like happened once, took me probably let me think about 10 days to remake it, like seven to 10 days. It was a crash stop. Okay, I had a crash stop, and I was exited out of my position because there was an unpredictable move that came out from nowhere. If it's like a regular move, first of all, you have an idea of the range of the average range of the product you trade. You adjust the size of your position of the maximum position you trade accordingly. And when it goes against you, the thing is try to exit as fast as you can. I'm always trying to exit as fast as I can. But sometimes, of course, once in a while, like probably I would say 10% of the time, you will have some trades where you will take a full stop. You will just need to exit. You cannot add to your scaling in position. And yeah, it happens. If you're cautious and you try to identify the right market conditions, it should not happen that often, but it will happen during a year. The question is that when it happens, what did you do wrong? Sometimes, and this is an important thing in the way I see trading, sometimes you make money, but you don't really have any you haven't done anything particularly well. But me, how I see those times where you lose and you take a full stop, actually you did good, because this is what is called equity preservation. You preserve you're doing the preservation of your trading equity. Okay. And yeah, this is a little bit the way I'm seeing things. Like in the beginning, of course, if you connected to it, very into it, you will feel bad. But after years, you just know that those days will come, one of those days. The only thing is that trying to maximize as much money as you can when it's working, so that you can deal with the losing days without wiping out too much of your monthly P&L, for example. That's if you didn't do anything wrong, but there is a news that is absolutely unexpected that is putting you out of the market, because you need to keep in mind that will always be a possibility. Another scenario is, you know what's happening. You know, you watch the book and you know, okay, someone is manipulating this thing and I'm right. Because he's pushing, he's like, basically he's trying to trigger all stops and then try to reverse the market. If it's like that, I will hedge myself on a correlated. Okay, but those are two different situations, and with experience you're able to see very clearly if it's like something you were not able to predict and you don't have any answer for it, and there you just need to take the loss. And if it's like something where someone is doing something and you're right. And usually, if you're able to hedge yourself and keep, so by hedging yourself, I mean take the opposite position in a correlated contract, or take the position in the same direction in a contract that have an inverted correlation, then usually those are the best trades. Okay. But that's it. Yeah, I'm not sure if it answers your question, Bruce.
Definitely. I mean, one of the things of this strategy as well. I mean, your point is very, very strong about being able to add in and scale out with multiple contracts, just allowing you to trade a zone instead of being right or wrong. One of the things that can be kind of frustrating, I think, especially for newer traders with that kind of strategy, is that maybe they only get in with one contract and they just nailed it, but they're only getting, you know, the profit on one contract. They would like to be able to scale in with multiples and try to leverage. How do you? I mean, I guess that's just part of the strategy, and you look for scaling in opportunities, but you just don't always get them.
Yeah, as I told you, the harder it is to get filled, the better it is, the better the trade is. Remember, you need to find someone willing to take the opposite side of your trade. If your trade is a good trade, it should be hard to enter. Okay. Sometimes something I do, because I'm thinking of what you're saying, but two additional things I would like to add regarding the question you asked me before. The first one, sometimes if I'm filled too easily, I exit immediately, because I believe that if I'm right, I should not be using certain specific strategy. I feel like if I'm able to be filled so easy, then something is wrong. It should not be that easy to get a fill, not at that place. So that's something that will put a filter. Then I found, like years ago, I think back then I made a video in French in 2010-11, because I've noticed in my P&L that there was a positive correlation between the number of scratch trades and the P&L. So the more I exit at the entry, because I believe it's not going well, the better the P&L. And also, the harder it is to get filled, the better the P&L. If you find the fill easy, like you put the order and you filled immediately, it's usually not a good thing. So I'm not sure if that helps.
Yes, very, very much so. Thank you, Kevin. Guys, there's a few more questions.
Just one last thing, Bruce, I wanted to add. I wanted to say it and I forgot it. Usually, you regarding also the question, how do you prevent the market to go massively against you? The whole job here, the key thing is to evaluate the volatility in the period you're going to keep the trade. So if you keep the trade for 1 minute, 45 seconds, 2 minutes, you should be able to evaluate the volatility. As soon as the volatility in the scalping timeframe you're working in starts to get bigger or way smaller than what you predicted, you're wrong, you should exit. Okay, so that's another filter, because the volatility usually it's not like at once it will increase, then it will decrease, then when it's low, it will start picking up. But usually it's not like at once without no news, no reason, the market will move 30 ticks in one direction. It doesn't really happen that way. It might happen, everything is possible, but having hours and hours of screen time, it's not something I have seen pretty often.
Really nice point. Guys, there's many questions here, still more questions. Kevin, I think it'd be great if we can go over another example.
Sure, I have a lot. I have a lot of them. I have a lot, and all of them are for. No, I'm done with those I had done for today. Let me see what else I have. We won't be able to go through everything because I have too much.
Right. Yeah, people are already hoping for part three of this webinar.
It will start to become like a Netflix series, you know?
Yeah, that's right.
Like season 275, episode 6. Okay, let me check. I'm not really sure what to show you guys. I have like... the sixth, I try to remember how it was looking, but the sixth was today, right? 1st of April, I think the close was interesting. Short squeeze and covering. I think I already, do you see my screen better than last time, this time?
Those other examples were excellent. This is similar to the example you were presenting on Thursday.
It's still the vertical screen, because you see even you guys you don't really have a trained eye for the order book, but when you look at Bookmap and you look at the book, you can clearly see that the volatility is different. If you look the size of the amplitudes of the move you do have on the order book, you can see that it's not the same type of market situation as what we had in the other examples. And this is also maybe why the other examples might be more suitable to for beginners to understand the concepts, because here it's going quite fast. And you see I'm stuck again, I'm trying to exit this, trying to do whatever I can, and I'm a little stuck. And I'm leaning a little bit on this zone, thinking, yeah. And here I saw clear rejection on 43 and 1/4, so I believe I might add there and have a little push again on that price level. And you see here, I'm already trying to find an exit. The most difficult thing here is to reassess the market conditions all the time, because if you take it in the middle of a market shift, it can be hard. But here, the volatility, keep in mind, the volatility is way bigger than what we had in the examples we had before. So the market might go way more against you than what it did when we were working in a short box. But the market might go way more in your direction as well. Okay, so it's true for both. So look here, if you see at Bookmap, there is the level of 449. And that's a level that I believe that the market will go and see, and he does it. Why? Because market is attracted by liquidity. And now we're during the last hour. Last hour, we're going into the close, and most of the people, asset managers, hedge funds, they try to do most of the business during the first hour and the last hour of trading. Okay, so you see, I'm keeping the last contract because since it's a short, actually what's happening here is a short squeezing. Okay, very typical action in the book, very typical action on Bookmap. Look on the right, you see all those balls. Who would put a massive buying order at the top of the move? Usually it's a stop. Okay, most of the time it's a couple of things that are mixed together. It's some people that still have a big order to fill. Those people, they start to fill, the market starts to push, and it feeds on more and more order. Yeah, you see here I exited it, and the market pushed. But always remember that some areas will give more steam and more steam to the move. And it's some very, very easily recognizable price action in the order book. Very easy to see if you know what to look for. Because in those times, it's done. The video is done here. In those times, the market is not retracing. You know, it's just pushing. But those times, you need to have your statistics in check, because you know that if you trade a market, you know when those directional moves tend to happen. Okay, if you take the statistics, and this is also something that you guys should do on a daily basis, and no matter if you trade like Kevin, like me, like Kevin does, like for a couple of ticks, or if you trade the longer time frame, take an Excel spreadsheet and write down what's the average volume of your instruments. What's the average volume pre-market? What's the average volume at 12 Eastern time? What's the average volume at 3:30 before the close? What's the usual average volume? What is usually the time where that market makes directional moves? At what time? Because you will see it's pretty, in the way it works, it's pretty, I won't say predictable because it changes sometimes, but it keeps doing over and over a set of same things. Okay, so you should know at what time it's more suitable to use a market making strategy, or a kind of what you guys would say like a type of contrarian strategy, even if you use like a 30-minute candles, or no, 20 minutes is maybe a bit long, but 15, 5, 2, 3-minute candles. Or at what time should you use trend strategies, and me, honestly, it's not often that I use trend strategies. Like earlier, I was trading gold. Gold is my trending market. If I want to trade a trend, I wait for gold to be in trend, and it's working wonders on gold. It's something like, again, I repeat, if you try to do like those strategies that I just showed you on gold, you won't be able to do anything with it. Okay, another video, Bruce, or some questions about
sure.
This one, maybe?
Sure, yeah, another video one? Would be great.
Yeah, I'm checking the time. Okay, we just 1 hour, so we're still within the boundaries. let me check. Problem is that I absolutely have no recall. Most of those videos, I've never watched them again. So quick scalps into the close. Well, let's see. I hope it's not the same. Oh, I have my video software that is making some trouble. I have another one here early. This one is working. Yeah, I hope you guys will be able to see. I'm not sure if we did this one already. This is early afternoon, 1st of April. April's Fool. And I, of course, I don't remember, so I have absolutely no idea. But it looks like the market is pretty quiet. It looks like the market is pretty quiet. You can see that those market conditions are very different to those ones of the video we just saw before. Very different. Smaller volatility. For now, I don't see much direction. We're kissing a large order. And sorry about the logo, guys. I will ask how to remove it. I have no idea how to remove that. Anytime I produce a video, it's there. But we just kissed and rejected on an order. We went to the other direction for a couple of ticks, and then we have continuation. Here, I believe that we're going to go and try to test more of the order at it's 483. So you see, I already have an exit order at 483, and I'm thinking of scaling back in where there was a cluster zone at 87. You can clearly see those levels in Bookmap. And I'm thinking of scratching. You see, I'm hesitating, and I see someone that is pushing the I scratched because I saw order of 124 contracts that pulled. You see, it's back there, and this is a fake order because as soon as the market went down, you see here it touched my. So slow, pop can pop on the ES inside. It popped inside my order. I don't really know what happened. I had some orders that were above at a key level, And sometimes this happens. It happened to me with gold. You don't even have the time to see your field that you already already positive. Okay, let's see how long this one is. Okay, it's longer. So slow that 125 can pop on the ES inside spread. Okay, this is very important. This is what we call like a market maker local market, a little bit more volatile than the one that we've seen in the first video. You have people that are confident showing 125 contracts order at the bid, and probably his total quantity is not 125. Okay, maybe I will pause this so that because I saw another thing that I wanted to talk about. Not the totality, but at least 100 contracts were flashed at the bid. Okay. Normally, if the market is volatile and there is activity and the tape is fast and you have a lot of orders coming in and hitting the market, well, you will have this order that will be filled, and no one will have the guts to do it. They will do it maybe at level two, level three, level four, not even level two. Starting from level three to level, a good level will be maybe level four, you know, to pretend like try to push and manipulate. You put an order at level four and you remove it. But if there is flow, you won't ever be able to put 120 lots at the inside bid and spread without getting someone taking you, or at least taking a good chunk of your order before you pull it. So this shows that this market is pretty controlled and is pretty a market making type of market. Okay, now I will go through, because you will see I'm interested in selling for 2489 and three quarters. And you will see my mouse going there, and I hesitate, and I'm not doing it. I feel like something was wrong in the way, and also I believe that the order will stay there and that the market will touch it, but the order was pulled. So I start to think, is it not someone pushing into the bids to try to buy? I hesitated and I didn't take it, and it's sad because it would have been a good trade, but I'm putting an order back, and now I believe I have gained more confidence toward that level, and so I'm a little bit more aggressive. I think I changed my order a little under it, and you can see very clearly on a Bookmap, huh, that level. But you see again, I'm not filled. And when I'm saying actually what I was, and I'm getting more aggressive here, you see. I believe the market will go back to kiss that liquidity level and try to see if it's real. But I think when I'm watching this, I don't think it's a good trade. I think it's something that was too aggressive with a poor risk reward. When I'm watching it, you see I'm exiting it. When I'm watching it, I don't feel like I should have done that trade. It's too aggressive. And actually, when I'm watching this, I feel like I'm a little out of sync with the market. I'm not very in the flow because I missed the opportunity there above. And then I think I was a little frustrated, and I wanted to work because the move to the short side was a little strong. So I believe maybe it will continue and go for an additional ticks. But you see, I quickly changed my mind and got my discipline in check and exited it. But that place to sell, if you ask me, this is not a trade that I should have done. It was a little bit too aggressive. Now, of course, I have only one market that I can follow, because I did not take all the markets at the same time. Maybe the reason why I did that is because a correlated like the Russell was breaking lows, and I believe the S&P will maybe follow. That might be an explanation, because when I'm watching that here, I'm not really convinced by that trade. Okay, let's see how long this is going. Okay, here there is a trade again. Yeah, another most important aspect is when to stay out. You see, at sometimes I feel like I don't have any edge. I don't know what's going on. And you see, sometimes for a couple of minutes, I'm not taking anything. If it lasts for 10, 15 minutes, then I might just think, there is nothing to do. Let's go maybe drink some water or take a look at the economical news economic news, sorry, and that's it. Okay, so here again, quick scalp. You see, this is typical. It's almost a strategy. A level worked immediately, and the level is rejected, and I'm filled, and I'm putting an order immediately there, so I have a good place in the line. So I have a good place in the line in case the market goes back there. And sometimes I walk 4 or 5 times in a row the same price, but it needs to go fast. You see, now we went away from it, and it's I'm already in the next 2 minutes watching the next 2 minute time frame of my scalping, watching what should I do, what can I do now. And also something else, because when I'm thinking, maybe I want you guys to understood well what I mean when I say that it's important to have difficulties to be filled when you're scalping. When I say difficulties to be filled, I mean when the market is going, touching your order, but you're not filled. That's a very good sign. I do not mean when the market is too high and it's, for example, you're trying to buy it and the market is going too high and you're not filled because you're not part of the move. I mean when the market is going, touching your order and going away and touching your order again, and you can see that there is some room, there are some people in front of you and you're getting a better place in the line, but it's still hard to get filled at that price. That's what I'm looking for. So here I have a very strong bias of a reversal due to the price action and the way the market went gradually down. Actually, I'm expecting that someone was accumulating a position to the long side, pushing the market down into his buying orders, and I believe that there will be a counter move. And I believe that the first level the market should go is the bookmap level at 80. And we went through, but I'm a little afraid because I believe it will push a little into it. Didn't happen. I'm re-evaluating the situation, thinking maybe of exiting at the break-even, or close to the break-even with a small loss. Now I see that I'm filled really easily at the level of 80. And I see that it's not going through, so I'm thinking of exiting the rest of the position there. And okay, something else that I didn't mention, when you trade multiples, as soon as you have a risk-free trade, you try to keep it as long as possible, and it usually pays up. You see now I have 2 contracts. I mean, for now, risk-free kind of trade, because I have already taken like about 7-10 ticks on the 2 first contracts, and I'm trying to say, okay, let's see, I have another exit here at 81.75, and if that is touched, I will try to hold the last contract as long as I can. But you see, it's not working very well. Quick scalps here and there, but nothing really strong. Me, I would like here to have the market when I'm watch bookmap, the level, and I'm showing it with my mouse, level of 82, and I'm filled, and I'm done. On to the next one. But at level of 82, even now when I'm watching it, it's pretty predictable. So a question you guys could ask yourself is, why didn't I keep it till the next level? Because due to the price action that was early, it was a mistake, but I should have kept it, but I could not tell due to the price action that we had before. I was a little I lost a little confidence. And here I thought of shorting it, but I thought it was maybe a little too aggressive. So I put an order at the second level. You can see on bookmap, you see right here at 88, and I put it a little above, expecting that if there was a push, the market will retreat immediately for 4 or 5 additional ticks, probably. So that concludes this video. And I think we almost at the end. Bruce, not sure if there are questions.
There's more. I'm sorry, guys. I don't think we're going to get to all of them. There's not too many left. One more question here is about: are you looking for also, you know, certain areas where traders are trapped, and then trying to enter knowing that there will be a squeeze?
I trade what I see. I try not to know anything. Like I know the context, but I try not to expect anything. I might increase my aggressivity. Like one of the examples I gave you, it was a short covering. So I was pretty aware that the short side was too easy, that it was the end of the session. It was Thursday and the market had been going down pretty much all day. And I was expecting some covering to some extent. And when I say going down, I mean in the book, there was downward pressure. So of course, I will be more aggressive in keeping a winner or more aggressive in entering a trade. But picking the bottoms is the hardest thing to do. Trading in the, when you use those strategies, trading in the middle of the range is easy because it's going back and forward and back and forward and you make quick money. But trying to catch a reversal is very hard. It's not something we do. And usually you never have the full reversal. You will have some of the a chunk of the middle of the reversal, but you won't have anything, everything. But of course, what I will do is, if I know that situation, that some people are trapped in the wrong side of the market and that the pain is increasing and that at some point they will need to exit and it will trigger some stops and more stops and more acceleration in the order flow, I will be more aggressive in keeping a winning trade. Now, I won't enter a trade based on that information. It's something that is part of my context info that will tell me, yeah, I want to keep it a little longer.
Understood. Let's see. Oh, just I have another question, and this would be for, because this is rather very intense trading, maybe this question will help other traders on a little bit higher time frames and not quite as intense. And is that the same strategies that you're using here on these time frames and range trading or scaling in and out of ranges? Would you also recommend that you can do that on higher time frames and just look at larger?
Actually, most of the consultancy I do when I work with hedge funds is based on. Because those guys, they enter trades like for, I've worked for a fund that is a multi-billion fund, so they don't care about quick scalps. It's like they have too much equity that they're not interested in taking any type of scalping. But they're interested in that because they want to optimize their average entries and they want to be aware of how to reduce their market impact when they're executing a major position because they've been losing a lot of money on those matters. So all those strategies that I might use, me, I don't know, 300, 400, 500 trades a day for quick profits, those are execution procedures for longer time frame traders. And when I say longer time frame, it doesn't matter. Even if you trade, on a daily chart, it's never bad to enter with an optimization of the entry of, for example, 20 or 15 additional ticks. It's always that to take in. It's something that you can do. If you trade like 5 minute, 1 minute, you can use the procedures of entries using the book and bookmap for a longer time frame, you know, or you can just use it as a filter, or you can use it to exit a position, you know, watching the current volatility, having an idea in the book and on bookmap, having an idea of the current market condition, market context. Are you in a market maker market? Are you in a directional market? Where are you willing to place your limit orders? Usually limit orders will always help you to save on your average position. I'm not sure if you guys trade how big you trade on the longer time frames, but it will always save. The fact of using limit orders will always save you some money and some ticks.
Right. Okay. Let's see, guys. I'm sorry if we didn't get to your questions, though. We've been going for an hour and a half now, or hour and 15 minutes. Kevin, we'd love to have you back again, and we'll just do it again. We'll give you a little bit of a rest now, though.
Today I didn't trade much. I just traded for the example, and I traded gold, which was a pleasure. It's very simple to trade gold. I feel like even a small child when it's trending, if you're explaining, it's so easy. I traded it for about 30 minutes, gold, and I did a little bit of S&P, so I'm pretty. I will paste. Last time I thought I was pasting it, but I didn't. I will paste the the box. I started to do videos in English. I'm not sure if I will continue. I know that back in 2016, when I done the webinar with Bookmap, and it was already with Bruce. And if you haven't watched it, you should watch it because it's a good one. Of course, Bookmap have evolved a lot and the markets have evolved also volatility wise since. But I share a lot of interesting info. And back then, the only answers I had was mainly from the institutional side of things. So I'm not sure if you guys are interested. I've done now a market analysis video, which is free. So I'm seeing a bit if there is an interest. So if you guys like it, just send me an email and tell me to continue. If not, I'm not sure if I will continue doing it. But I have done a complete market wrap for this week. And a little bit of research regarding the news, so you can take a look at it.
Okay, excellent. So yeah, guys, he pasted it in there, and I repasted it, so you guys have it for sure. And you can sign up there. And if we didn't get to any of your questions, please, then you can reach out directly to Kevin. I've put in here several times all his contact information as well as the recording from part one. We will have the recording for part two here on our YouTube channel a bit later this afternoon. Give us some time to let it, parse and produce here. Other than that, any parting words, Kevin?
No, guys, stay safe. Feel free to send me emails. I'm locked down. So besides trading and answering emails and making presentation, this is one of the reason why I'm very present online those days because I have no way to go. So feel free to send me messages. Don't get too overwhelmed. The strategies have a very high ratio of winning, but it takes some time and some work to be able to recognize market conditions, and one single trade can of course wipe out 10 trades, so you need to keep that in mind. Besides of that, thank you for attending, and stay safe, all of you guys.
Okay, excellent. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you, Bruce. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye,
guys.